In this video, we're given a rather large coil. It has 10,000 turns, a diameter of 50 centimeters, and it's rotating from the coil orientation being parallel to the magnetic field to being perpendicular to the magnetic field. And what we're using here to induce an EMF is actually just the magnetic field of the Earth, which is rather weak. So I'm saying it's half a Gauss here. And we do this 90 degree turn in 0.8 seconds. So I can see that in the initial state, the magnetic flux is zero. And that's because the plane of each of the loops in this coil is parallel to the magnetic field. So there are no magnetic field lines penetrating the loops. There's no magnetic flux. In the second picture, I have maximum magnetic flux. Every turn in that coil is perpendicular to the magnetic field, and this maximizes the number of captured field lines. So you might remember that the flux formula is given by AB cosine theta, where that angle is measured between a normal vector for the coil and the direction of the magnetic field. And that angle is going to be either 0 or 180. It doesn't matter because we're not concerned about sines here. So the cosine part turns out to be a 1. And I end up with a magnetic flux in the final state. And this is just the flux for one turn of the coil given by A times B. So I need the area of a loop. You can use pi r squared, or you could use 1/4 pi diameter squared. Same thing, times the strength of the magnetic field. And I plug in the numbers. That's 1/4 pi times 0.5 squared times the strength of the magnetic field. Now this needs to be expressed in Tesla. And the conversion is that a Gauss is 10 to the negative 4th Tesla. So we can turn this magnetic field into 5 times 10 to the negative 5th Tesla. And I get a flux per loop of 9.82 times 10 to the negative 6th Tesla meters squared. Now that I have the change in the flux for this rotation, I can invoke Faraday's law. And I'm just going to write this for the magnitude of the induced EMF because we don't care about the direction. That's going to be N, that's the number of loops, that's where it comes into the calculation, times the rate of change in the magnetic flux through one loop. And we have 10,000 loops. And we have a change in flux, that's final minus initial. Because the initial was zero, this is simple. It's just the final value over the amount of time it took to change that flux. That was 0.8 seconds. And I get 0.123 volts induced by rotating this coil. In part B, we're asked to compute the necessary sustained rotation rate of the coil to produce an RMS voltage, or EMF, the way I said it here, of 1.0 volts by using the Earth's magnetic field. So now we're going to appeal to the generator formula, and I'll post a link real quick to where this was derived. And I'm thinking about the sustained voltage that's produced by continuing this rotation over time. And the generator formula said this: the voltage as a function of time produced by a rotating loop in a magnetic field is given by some peak value times the sine of omega t, where omega is the angular velocity in radians per second. And it turned out that peak value is given by NAB times omega. Now in this case, we want to get an RMS, or root mean squared, voltage of 1 volt. And we have to relate that to the peak voltage. So I'll post a link real quick to the video where this was first introduced, when we were first looking at AC circuits. And the relationship is that the RMS value is 1/√2 times the peak value. Since we're looking at an RMS value of 1 volt in this case, it means our peak value is √2 times 1 volt, or √2 volts. So that's what we're going to plug in for the peak voltage in the generator formula. So I'm going to go ahead and solve this formula for omega. Omega is our peak voltage divided by NAB. Our peak voltage is given by √2 volts. N is the number of turns, that's 10,000. A, again, is 1/4 pi times diameter squared, so 0.5 squared. And B is 5 times 10 to the negative 5th Tesla. When I run the numbers on this, I get 14.4 radians per second. And that's a rotation rate but I want to convert that to rotations per minute, which is a more standard way of talking about how fast things are spinning. So I take my 14.4 radians per second. I multiply by the conversion factor, 2 pi radians, in the denominator for every one rotation. And another one, 60 seconds in the numerator for every 1 minute in the denominator. Cancel my radians, cancel my seconds. And when I run the numbers on this to 3 sig figs, I get 138 rotations per minute. So as I pointed out in the video for the generator formula, this idea of a coil rotating in a magnetic field is the basis of how we generate electrical power. It would be true for a coil driven by a windmill or a steam-driven turbine in a gas-powered or nuclear-powered power plants, or a coil driven by the turbine in a hydroelectric dam. You just put an axle through one of these things, use some kind of source of mechanical energy to spin it around, and you're automatically generating alternating currents. In this case, all you have to do is take this relatively small coil and spin it a little faster than 2 revolutions per second, and you're going to read an RMS value of 1 volt at the terminals. If you find the physics content on Zach's Lab helpful, click on the Zach's Lab logo on the right to browse playlists and subscribe to the channel. I produce over 100 new videos per month, and subscribing is the easiest way to find new content. Thanks for watching.